Our most beloved living ex-president, Barack Obama, was called by New York Times journalist James Risen, quote, the greatest enemy of press freedom in a generation.
As we approach the November presidential election, the stakes couldn't be higher. Kamala Harris stands under Barack Obama's support, a historic figure often celebrated for his charisma and oratory skills. However, beneath this facade lies a legacy riddled with decisions that have sparked significant criticism and controversy. Many fear that Donald Trump will target immigrants, but let's not forget who actually deported millions and expanded unnecessary military conflicts. Obama himself.
And stop trying to deport millions of striving young kids who just want to earn their shot at the American dream like the rest of us. Help us fix a broken immigration system.
People are worried that Trump will be a dictator, but when you look closely at the numbers, you'll see that Obama was the real dictator. And as he backs Harris, it's time to shine a light on the challenges that have persisted since his presidency. Are we truly ready to continue down this path, or is it time to critically examine the legacy that has been handed to us? One of the most contentious aspects of Obama's presidency was his extensive use of drone strikes. His administration authorized a staggering increase in drone warfare, conducting 10 times more strikes than his predecessor, George W. Bush. This aggressive military strategy resulted in numerous civilian casualties, notably the deliberate death sentence or assassination of Anwar Awlaki, an American citizen, by a drone strike which occurred without any trial or due process. But he wasn't the only one. Awlaki's 16-year-old son, Abdul Rahman, and Awlaki's wife also received the same sentence, executed on a separate drone strike along with Samir Khan and Jude Muhammad, who grew up in North Carolina, who were mistakenly targeted. The Obama administration's acknowledgement of civilian casualties raises critical moral questions about the justifications for such actions.
To say a military tactic is legal or even effective is not to say it is wise or moral in every instance. The same progress that gives us the technology to strike half a world away also demands the discipline to constrain that power or risk abusing it.
It seems like Barack Obama failed to follow his own advice on this, or maybe he is the only one allowed to abuse it? I'll let you decide. In total, the Obama administration's drone strikes are estimated to have caused civilian casualties in the hundreds, with reports indicating that strikes in Pakistan and Yemen alone resulted in the deaths of innocent civilians, including American aid worker Warren Weinstein and Italian humanitarian Giovanni Laporto, who were held hostage. The administration claimed ignorance about the hostages' presence, and despite Obama's promises of transparency, his press secretary was evasive and unable to explain how the strikes could be considered a mistake.
There are some details, including some very basic details, that I will not be in a position to discuss. Josh, I won't be able to provide specific numbers on this. Certain aspects of the specific operation that I'm not going to be able to discuss, including how the specific operation was carried out.
The mantra of saving lives through drone strikes often contradicted the reality of civilian deaths, painting a grim picture of the moral implications of such military actions.
Before any strike is taken, there must be near certainty that no civilians will be killed or injured.
Transitioning from military policy to domestic issues, Obama earned the title of Deporter-in-Chief. His administration deported over 3 million individuals, more than any other president in history. In fact, Obama deported more people in his 8 years in office than all the presidents of the 20th century combined. Let me break this down for you. Obama managed to deport more people in 8 years than 100 years of 17 other presidents combined. This high volume of deportations raises critical questions about the human impact of these policies. And let's see what he has to say about deportation at the DNC meeting of 2015, after being the president for 6 years and being the biggest deporter in chief.
Stop trying to deport millions of striving young kids who just want to earn their shot at the American dream like the rest of us. Help us fix a broken immigration system.
Is it just me, or can this be categorized as hypocrisy? Let's see how Obama treated those striving young kids who wanted to earn their shot at the American dream. His administration claimed that the vast majority of deported individuals were criminals or threats to national security, but a study conducted in 2014 found that two-thirds of deportation cases involve people who had committed minor infractions, including traffic violations, or had no criminal record at all. For example, the tragic case of Jose Marvin Martinez, a striving young kid who wanted to earn his shot at the American dream. Jose Marvin Martinez fled Honduras at the age of 16 after his brother was murdered by suspected gang members. In 2014, he was deported back to his home country, where, just 4 months later, he was shot to death by gang members. Another heartbreaking story is that of Giovanni Miranda, another striving young kid who wanted to earn his shot at the American dream. Giovanni Miranda arrived in the United States as a child and was working legally. After a minor traffic accident in 2009, immigration officers discovered he had a minor drug possession charge from 7 years earlier. They deported him back to El Salvador, a homeland he had never truly known. 3 years after his return, he was murdered by a gang in front of his wife and newborn child. These are just two out of tens of thousands of real-life stories of striving young kids who wanted to earn their shot at the American dream. These are real-world tragedies that many argue will forever taint Obama's record on human rights, particularly concerning immigration. His administration's aggressive stance on immigration has left a lasting mark on countless lives and sparked ongoing debates about human rights and immigration reform in America.
Help us fix a broken immigration system!
Critics argue that he not only fixed the broken immigration system, but created a deportation machine that would later be exploited by his successor, Donald Trump. The Obama administration spent $22 billion on immigration in 2016 alone. Not just that, during Obama's presidency, nearly $9 trillion in debt was added, pushing the national debt to over $20 trillion.
We know that if we close loopholes that allow the top 1% to avoid paying taxes on their accumulated wealth, we can use that money to help more middle-class families pay for childcare and send their kids to college, and that will help the entire economy grow.
To stimulate growth following the 2008 financial crisis, the Federal Reserve kept interest rates near zero for 8 years. This was meant to encourage borrowing and spending by making loans cheaper. However, when the government prints money and increases the money supply without immediately increasing the number of goods and services available, it creates a situation where there's more money than products to buy. Think of it this way. If a store has 100 apples and suddenly everyone in town has extra money, the demand for apples increases. But since there are still only 100 apples, the store owner can raise the price from $1 to $2 because people are willing to pay more to be the ones who get the apples. This increase in prices is called inflation. When you only have $100, every dollar feels valuable. But once you have $1,000, spending $10 doesn't seem as significant, and you're more willing to spend it on items that may not be as important. As more money circulates in the economy, the value of each dollar decreases. This means that while you may have the same amount of money, it buys you less over time. For the average American, this means struggling to keep up with rising costs, especially when wages don't increase as quickly as prices.
There are a lot of ways to help the middle class.
The middle class suffers the most in these scenarios, as they lack the financial tools to hedge against inflation, making everyday expenses increasingly burdensome. Critics label this period of economic policy as Obamanomics, which is characterized by moderate tax increases on higher-income Americans designed to fund healthcare reform and other initiatives. However, this approach can have negative consequences for the economy as a whole. Increasing taxes on higher-income individuals may seem like a solution to help the less fortunate, but it can discourage investment and entrepreneurship. Wealthy individuals and businesses often drive economic growth through job creation and innovation. When they face higher taxes, they may choose to invest less or relocate their resources elsewhere, ultimately stifling economic progress.
We know that if we close loopholes that allow the top 1% to avoid paying taxes on their accumulated wealth, we can use that money to help more middle-class families pay for childcare and send their kids to college, and that will help the entire economy grow.
Moreover, the push for free healthcare, while well-intentioned, can lead to significant economic strain. Funding such initiatives typically requires higher taxes, which can burden taxpayers and businesses alike. Additionally, when healthcare is provided for free, it can result in increased demand for services without a corresponding increase in supply, leading to longer wait times and potentially lower quality care. This blend of policies can create a cycle where the government grows larger and more intrusive, often leaning towards socialist inclinations. Such approaches can reduce the overall efficiency of the economy. The repercussions of these policies are still felt by all Americans today as they grapple with the consequences of an expanding government. With the recent announcement from China regarding the largest stimulus package in years to revive its faltering economy, it is crucial for America to make the right decisions to avoid similar economic pitfalls. As China seeks to stabilize its stock market and real estate sector, the U.S. must learn from these developments and ensure sound economic policies to prevent falling into the same downward spiral. This brings us to foreign policy. Obama campaigned on a promise to end the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. However, by the end of his presidency, the number of countries with U.S. military involvement had expanded from 4 to 7. While he withdrew troops from Iraq, he significantly increased the use of drone strikes in Afghanistan and beyond. In his first year alone, Obama authorized 52 drone strikes compared to just 48 over Bush's entire 8 years. The justification for these operations often centered on the idea that they would minimize American casualties while targeting terrorist threats, and we already know this did not end well for hundreds of people. Moreover, Obama's involvement in international politics often led to instability. For instance, his administration played a big role in the ousting of Ukraine's elected president in 2014, which many argue set the stage for the ongoing conflict between Ukraine and Russia, because in the same week of the coup in Ukraine, Russia's response was to invade the country. By backing a coup, Obama contributed to a geopolitical crisis that has lasting implications. This raises another critical question. At what point does foreign intervention become damaging rather than beneficial? The invasion of Ukraine actually paused during Donald Trump's years in office. Let's not forget about the promise to close Guantanamo Bay, a detention facility established in 2002 to hold suspected terrorists captured during the War on Terror.
A Guantanamo that is open when we suspend habeas corpus.
We're going to lead by shutting down Guantanamo and restoring habeas corpus in this country.
Situations like Guantanamo, where we've suspended habeas corpus.
I have said repeatedly that I intend to close Guantanamo, and I will follow through on that.
This facility has become a controversial symbol of America's post-9/11 counterterrorism policies, often criticized for its lack of due process and harsh treatment of detainees. Obama famously won the Nobel Peace Prize for his commitment to closing Guantanamo, arguing that its existence undermined America's moral standing in the world and contradicted the values of justice and human rights.
Once we commit to a process of closing Gitmo, I am confident that this legacy problem can be resolved, consistent with our commitment to the rule of law. And I know the politics are hard, but history will cast a harsh judgment on this aspect of our fight against terrorism and those of us who fail to end it.
Yet despite his assurances, Guantanamo Bay remains operational to this day. Obama acknowledged that future generations would judge those who failed to close it, but it seems he has become part of that failure himself. The continued existence of the facility raises serious questions about the effectiveness of his administration's approach to national security and human rights, leaving a lasting blemish on his legacy. Now, people say that Donald Trump manipulates the media and that he does not respect journalism. So let's talk about Obama's stance on transparency, or rather the lack of it, during the Obama administration.
Special interests will form around these centers of power, and as Friedrich Hayek accurately predicted about conventional socialism, the worst will get on top, because power-hungry people are mainly the ones who end up on top. Our most beloved living ex-president, Barack Obama, was called by New York Times journalist James Risen, quote, the greatest enemy of press freedom in a generation, unquote. As left-wing journalist Glenn Greenwald has pointed out, Obama used the archaic 1917 Espionage Act to prosecute more journalists, including James Risen, than all previous presidents combined. So freedom of speech and press is a fragile thing, constantly being assaulted on all sides, and especially by government.
In fact, they set records for withholding information under the Freedom of Information Act, FOIA, a law that allows the public to request access to records from federal agencies. FOIA is designed to promote transparency in government, ensuring that citizens can obtain information about how their government operates. In Obama's final year alone, the government spent a staggering $36 million on FOIA lawsuits. This clearly highlights the issues surrounding transparency during his presidency. One notable case involved former New York Times reporter Christopher Hedges, who filed a lawsuit against the National Defense Authorization Act. This legislation allowed for the indefinite detention of individuals based on vague allegations, raising serious alarms about civil liberties. Essentially, it gave the military the power to imprison journalists, activists, and human rights advocates without due process. These actions sparked fierce debates about the balance between national security and individual rights. When a government can detain people without a fair trial, it opens the door for potential abuse of power, leaving many to wonder, just how much freedom are we willing to sacrifice in the name of security? As we approach the next presidential election, Kamala Harris stands as the Democratic candidate, heavily supported by Obama. This continuation of Obama-era policies raises red flags for those concerned about the future of the economy, freedom, and foreign relations. Recently, Harris discussed blockchain in a public speech for the first time, expressing support for encouraging new technologies, including digital assets. However, she stressed the need for consumer protections, raising questions about how this will be implemented. Will this mean increased regulations and government interference in the market? Unlike her Republican rival Donald Trump, who has become an advocate for cryptocurrencies, Harris has remained relatively quiet on her views until now. In her 82-page economic plan released alongside her speech, she references digital assets in a single sentence, which seems to indicate a limited focus on crypto. While she states her administration will encourage innovative technologies like AI and digital assets while protecting our consumers and investors, the brevity of this mention leaves many wondering about her actual commitment to the crypto space. If you found value in this discussion, make sure to hit that like button and subscribe for more thought-provoking content. Your support keeps the conversation going and helps others discover these important topics. So, what's the ultimate takeaway? Obama's presidency has been marked by a series of decisions that not only failed to unite and strengthen America, but also contributed to ongoing division and economic instability. As Kamala Harris steps into the spotlight, it's crucial for voters to consider whether they want to continue down the same path or seek a new direction for the country. In reflecting on Obama's legacy, we must ask ourselves, have we truly learned from the past, or are we destined to repeat the same mistakes? That's a wrap for today, everyone. Remember, history isn't just about the past, it's a lesson for our future. Until next time, stay curious and stay hodling.